Could you come up with a more emissions intensive way to generate electricity than the hydrogen energy supply chains plan? This is a collaboration between Australia and Japan, and it starts in Australia's Latrobe Valley in Victoria, where they take brown coal, then they gasify it to make hydrogen, and they just let the CO2 release into the atmosphere with no carbon capture. Then they truck the hydrogen gas 160 kilometres to a hydrogen liquefaction storage and loading terminal at Hastings, where they're going to have to use one third of its energy contents to liquefy it. And then actually, as I speak, there is a brand new purpose-built ship waiting there in the port to take that liquid hydrogen and transport it 8,000 kilometres to Kobe, Japan, where the eventual plan is to use whatever hydrogen remains after conversion losses and leakage to run fuel cell cars or generate electricity. Vastly more complex than simply shipping the coal and using that to make electricity, and with far higher CO2 emissions too. So that is an incredibly high emissions and complicated way to make electricity. Yet I, an engineer who spent her whole career fighting climate change, I think it's a great idea, and I'm not even joking. I know this is a controversial opinion. To be clear, I do not think this is a clean project, despite it constantly being described using that word. This one article I read uses the word clean 7 times. It's not clean energy. It's not green energy. It's not low emissions energy. It is highly polluting, highly emitting stuff. And if you think of it as a project with the goal to just make electricity, it's incredibly stupid, or it's disingenuous, or it's both, as many others have pointed out. The reason that I think it's a great project is not for its clean energy potential, but rather its risk mitigation potential. This will be the world's first project to test the technical feasibility of hydrogen export without converting it into some other form to make it easier to transport. So as such, it will provide key information we can use to update our ideas of the size of the role that hydrogen is going to be able to play in the clean energy transition. If hydrogen transport is technically or economically infeasible, then so is a lot of the whole hydrogen economy that everyone keeps talking about. It's better to know that now than after 10 years and $300 billion have been spent on hydrogen investments. Transporting hydrogen long distances is a key part of many countries' hydrogen plans. This includes Germany, Japan, and Korea, for example. It's also one of the biggest technical and commercial risks. Currently, the very, very vast majority of hydrogen is produced right where it's used. And this is done precisely because it is so difficult and so expensive to transport. Those countries who have hydrogen imports as part of their clean energy plans, they expect that the technical and economic issues associated with hydrogen transport can be solved. But until someone actually transports hydrogen a long distance, we are not going to know the true scale of the challenge. And this is a big risk for the clean energy roadmaps based on importing or exporting hydrogen. The HESC project should quickly find out how hard it will be to transport liquid hydrogen long distances. As long as the experiences are shared, this new knowledge will allow realistic cost projections for future projects. And if major technical obstacles are encountered, it could allow us to shift focus to alternative hydrogen transport options, such as via ammonia, which they are actually already trialling in Japan, as well as this liquid hydrogen transport option. Or we might decide to shift away from long-distance hydrogen transport at all. It's exactly what I would do if I was in charge of project managing the world's transition to a hydrogen economy. You assess the biggest technical risks and then test them out as fast as possible. We have had so many announcements, so much talking about hydrogen in the past couple of years, and there is vigorous debate about whether the economics of many hydrogen applications make sense, but there is mostly agreement about what the technical challenges associated with a hydrogen economy are. They're going to be transport, storage, and distribution. But what is not agreed is how easily the technical challenges can be solved and whether the solutions can ever be economical, relative to alternative technologies like battery storage and direct electrification. So these are engineering issues, and engineering issues are best solved with doing, not talking. So that's why I'm in favor of this project, which is actually starting to do something. So I'm keen to see a series of fast and sometimes dirty risk reduction projects. The ATSC project to address the feasibility of long-distance hydrogen trade is one of them. Other fast hydrogen trials that are happening right now include the power-to-gas project in progress in Rotterdam, and there's a lot of other really similar ones, which are testing how easily existing natural gas pipelines can be used for hydrogen and trialing hydrogen boilers for home heating. Also, whilst the technical feasibility of using hydrogen to produce electricity isn't in doubt, we can definitely do that. Being able to do it on a large scale is going to depend on our ability to store large amounts of hydrogen, which does need its technical feasibility established. So there are a lot of ideas about how we can store large volumes of hydrogen, but I haven't seen any significant hydrogen storage projects that have actually started yet to find out, you know, what the small complications are going to be and how much it's going to cost to solve those. And the economics of generating large amounts of electricity from hydrogen can't be assessed until we know how we're going to store and transport it. The HCSC project has a series of other technical risks to overcome before it will be viable. They need to get carbon capture to work, which has so far proven beyond our capabilities in Australia after 3 decades of trying pretty hard. They need to find a suitable storage facility for the CO2. I think that they're still only in the exploratory drilling phase currently. And they need to face the economic realities of trying to make money from a carbon capture project in a country that is steadfastly committed to not putting a price on carbon. For now, they're using offsets while they try to figure out how to add CCS. But I might cynically suggest that what they're really offsetting is public outrage at what is essentially simply an incredibly high emissions way to make electricity. So I'm not really very hopeful that this specific project is going to prove viable and, you know, go on to contribute like a lot of clean energy to the world. But if this hydrogen transport project uncovers insurmountable technical challenges, or if it turns out to be harder or more expensive than expected, well, that is a success in my eyes. It'll probably seem like a failure for the companies and the governments whose money is on the line. But from the perspective of everyone else, this failure will be a huge success because we'll know in time to adjust our energy transition plans and avoid spending research effort and funds on an aspect of the hydrogen economy that was just never going to work. To me, this knowledge is certainly worth the CO2 emissions from this fast and dirty little project. Thanks for watching. And if you would like to see more videos like this, then you might like to consider joining the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team. I will put the link in the description. I'll see you in the next video.